there. I thank the ISMPO and Govind Babu and Suresh and the whole ISMPO team for this invitation. And Rajiv for that excellent presentation. Too much of information, Rajiv. I really don't know what we are looking to cover. But few things, maybe first starting with prostate, then going to kidney, and then wrap it up with bladder. In the era when we are trying to do more and more, let's see whether we can do less and less. So just one scenario for our surgeon, which patient with prostate cancer would he be very comfortable to observe in a fit individual? So, Dr. Raju, your thoughts?
Yeah, generally with the patients who are very low risk category, that means with the PSA less than 10 units, and who has a very high probability of a survival more than 20 years as per the NCCN guidelines, are the current standard indications for keeping them under active surveillance program. And some of the low-risk category patients also can be observed and can be kept under active surveillance programs. The rest probably would require a judicious decision-making whether to go for an active intervention or a surveillance programs.
Anything specific, Raju, how will you follow them up?
We need to carry out investigations in the form of a PSA and a magnetic MRI evaluation annually, and then look for the PSA velocity. And these are the determining factors which will enable the clinician whether to an intervention is needed or not. As per some of the data that are available, a large number of patients can escape the treatment modalities, be it surgery or radiation treatment.
Okay, so the main thought about following them would be to avoid unnecessary treatment. Would that be the point?
Yes.
And we can catch those people who need treatment and provide them with the appropriate treatment.
True, but the issue is that we don't have mature data. This is based upon some of the retrospective data that we have and some of the observational studies. And so it's not very, except in Western countries where they have set up cities. It is feasible, but I don't know whether we are following this in our country.
Yeah, that would be quite
difficult. I want the analyst's opinion on that.
Yeah, I will ask them one by one a different question. But what you're saying is absolutely right, because it would need a dedicated patient himself to keep coming in. And then we have to convince him for another biopsy, possibly at a year, a confirmatory biopsy. And we need to do this MP-MRI and then take our decision. So outcome-wise, you feel how many of them you think would ultimately need treatment when they are on active surveillance? What, 10 of them, 20, 30, how much?
Around 20-25%. Around 20-25% would require some kind of treatment if you observe them over long periods. Whatever limited data that is available, they again show that the survival is not significantly altered.
I think Dr. Raju has said it very well. If you follow them over 10, 12 years, most of them are alive. But when they are on active surveillance, they are alive, but slightly more chance of alive with disease. So that is one small negative point is there. And in the initial trials, like the PIVOT trial or the PROTECT trial or the Scandinavian trial, they didn't have the MRI as a risk stratification point. And they were not diligently calling them in every 3 months, 6 months for various testing. So some of the patients were missed out, and they had progressed. But right now, when they did an audit in UK, they found that only a very small percentage, only about 6% of patients who were classified as low risk, received a radical treatment. So majority went on an active surveillance, but like you rightly said, may not be the one for our country. It needs a dedicated unit to take care of these patients. So now coming to the treatment part, this is towards Mansi, because initial days, if you had a castrate-resistant prostate cancer, we would think that our longevity is only a year or so. But now there are a lot of molecules coming in that space. And in that, I'm looking at a very specific area. Patient is non-metastatic and has CRPC. First, my question is, when would this such a scenario come across? And what are your thoughts about managing this? This is for Mansi. Can hear me, Mansi?
Yes, I'm sorry. I was like muted, so I just unmuted myself. Good morning, sir. Good morning, everyone. Good morning. So, sir, what you're asking is M0 castrate-resistant prostate cancer.
Yes.
In what scenarios we encounter then? So, I think one of the most common scenarios is patients who have undergone local therapy several years ago, and now they seem to have a rising PSA. That is probably one of the most common scenarios that we see these patients in. Unfortunately, we don't see a lot of patients who are currently undergoing, say, for example, RT plus ADT for like 2 years or something, and on treatment they progress with a rising PSA. That is usually a less likely scenario. In terms of how you deal with these patients, I think, first of all, usually when we see a rising PSA, but no obvious mets on like CT scans or bone scans, if possible, maybe if a PSMA PET scan is available, maybe we can do a PSMA scan just to see if there are metastases that we have missed on conventional imaging. And if there is no evidence of mets, I think some of the things that are very important to see is what is the PSA doubling time, because I think we have data that if the PSA doubling time is less than 10 months, then those patients tend to do pretty poorly in terms of overall survival. So I think, sir, we have three agents approved, but in India we just have the enzalutamide, which is available. We don't have apalutamide or that darolutamide, which is available. So just speaking on Enza, we have data to support the use of enzalutamide in M0 castrate resistant prostate cancer, especially in patients who are high risk with a PSA doubling time of less than 10 months in terms of improving metastasis free survival and also overall survival. I think there is probably like almost like a 16 month or 24 month difference in the patients who receive enzalutamide. So I think that is one drug that we can think of in these patients.
Very good, Mansi. I think you put it very succinctly. Any special problems because with enzalutamide? And if you had all the opportunity, you could use any of the drug, then what is your take on that? And any specific reason?
So, sir, not having used darolutamide, but I think from what I've read, it is probably a little bit better tolerated than enzalutamide in terms of cognitive dysfunction because it does not cross the blood-brain barrier. In terms of enzalutamide, I think most patients tolerate it pretty well, except for fatigue is definitely one issue. Hypertension in some patients that we need to monitor, and otherwise the regular things like liver enzymes and electrolytes, osteoporosis risk, the usual things that we usually monitor in these patients. But otherwise, good. Pretty well tolerated.
Yeah. So you made the key point that if they are castrate resistant and still non-metastatic, that segment could become less now because more and more if we do the PSMA scan, possibly that segment could be less. But if they are high risk, like you rightly mentioned, they could, within a short time, within 2 years, get metastatic disease in the bone. And by treating them early, definitely you could keep the disease away. And the curves have really well separated at all the endpoints. And drug being reasonably tolerated well, I think, and the cost coming down, it could become a good option. So my question next to our doctor Manisha, Manisha from Patna, because we heard Dr. Rajiv mentioning a lot about the genomics, stratification, etc. So, Manisha, if a patient comes to you, what are these newer tests? Because normally we just ask for a routine biopsy, and even IHC is rarely asked by us. Because most of the time they give a good report of adenocarcinoma of the prostate. But after Rajiv's presentation and whatever has come out in 2020, would you look at anything else, Manisha?
Definitely. Very good question, sir. Definitely today, even for prostate cancer, we are looking forward for something in the era which we didn't have much to offer. So for metastatic castration-resistant prostate cancers specifically, we are talking about, we are talking in terms of the genetic testing and molecular testing as well. So the reason behind, the NGS now has allowed us to classify on the basis of genomic, proteomic, transcriptomic basis, to classify these prostate cancers into ETS-specific and ETS-specific positive and negative tumors, according to which we now classify if the patients, they are rich in P53, P10, or they are negative with ETS subscription, like we talk about these SPOP, because each subset behaves in a different manner, and each subset, you know, has a different propensity for these AR signaling. Now, talking about genetically specific, when we talk about, so we see that we are testing for BRCA1, we are testing for BRCA2 and something like that, because taking forward the trial that was a profound trial, which is very, you know, specific when we talk about castration-resistant prostate cancer these days, because this is the first trial ever which has, you know, categorized on genomic sequences the optimal stratification of treatment which can be offered to prostate cancers. So if I can just go in the detail of this trial, that on this genetic testing, we categorized patients into two cohorts. The cohort A were the patients who were positive for BRCA1, BRCA2, or ATM gene, and the rest, cohort B, they were positive for other genes, directly or indirectly related to the HRR repair mechanism. Now, for the cohort A patient, we offered them olaparib, and for the cohort B, we offered them enzalutamide or albuterol acetate. And it was very interesting to find out the primary endpoint was to see the radiological PFS, and it was really exciting that the radiological PFS was 7.4 for the olaparib, and it was just 3.5 for the cohort B. And again, in terms of, you know, the overall response rate, it was again very significant. It was 33% for the cohort A and 2.3 just for the cohort B. Even the median overall survival and the time to, delay of pain happening in this patient was also in favor. Talking about the toxicities, yes, the toxicities were a little higher for the olaparib in terms of anemia, fatigue, fatigue, and the patient had neutropenia. And the dropout rate was 16.4% in the olaparib arm, but the trial was very much convincing for those subsets, especially those subset of the patient when we are saturated and we don't have much to offer, and the patient have failed on the traditional drug that we talk about. So the subset of the patient who had these genetic testing positive, now we had option that we can offer drug and that we can extend the PFS. So I think and also the second key point was that the patient who were not positive for BRCA1, BRCA2 or ATM, the other subgroup, they were, you know, the candidate whom immunotherapies can be offered. So now we have new data is coming up that these subsets on genetic classification, you can think of offering something more that we couldn't offer till date. And then we can, in fact, enroll these patients into more and more trials. And also we can predict that these subset of the patient, are there risk for any second cancer or any other cancer, or their families can have these cancers. So this genetic testing, which has upcome in a very big way in prostate cancers, are definitely, you know, very encouraging, and will probably in due course of time will offer more to these castration resistant prostatic cancers.
Yes, Manisha, just because we had lost you online at the time, which patient, when would you recommend, that's all, very shortly just tell, you're going to recommend this at this time of the patient's natural history.
So who are the patients? Suppose if the patient had a close relative tested positive for genetic testing. The patient had a diagnosis of, you know, prostatic cancer at a very early age, or the diagnosis was metastatic prostatic cancer at presentation. The patient had a very high risk of prostate cancer, or in the family, the patient had the disease. Suppose if she had a, any of a family member had a breast cancer at a lesser age, that was less than 50, patient had a prostate or pancreatic cancer in the family at an early age, they are the subset of the patients who should be, I mean, at this point of time, they should be, you know, subjected to this BRCA testing. Otherwise, a patient, if they had a low-risk disease or the none of the family members had, so we should not subject all the patient, but the subset upfront should be tested for BRCA, I think.
Okay, good. So one more quick comment on the AKT pathway inhibition. So that has also come up as the plenary talk this year, along with the profound which you mentioned. A quick two lines on the AKT pathway.
Yes, it is said that prostatic cancers, they exhibit up to 30 to 50%. This P13K AKT mTOR pathway is upregulated, especially when there is a P10 negativity. And it was seen that the patient who had, in 90% of the P10 negative patient with a high this AKT level, they had a near total recurrence of biochemical failure in all these patients. 90% of the patient, they had a biochemical failure. So we have a drug upcoming, that is the ipatasertib, which is an AKT inhibitor for such subgroup of the patients. Because if the patient had AKT, I mean, negative, and they had the P10 positive, 85% of the patient, they did not recur. So this is something bad that we are talking about. And we have an upcoming drug, probably in years to come, we will be more focused and we have more robust data to use such AKT inhibitors in prostate cancer, which is also of a, you know, will be of great help in these patients.
Okay, thank you, Manisha. So I'll come back to the surgeon once again. We'll try to come to kidney cancer. Rajiv had mentioned regarding the Karina trial. So once again, for the practitioner, what would be your advice? There's a metastatic RCC with the trial mentioned in 2018. What would be Dr. Raju's thought? Should we do a nephrectomy or we should not do a nephrectomy? What is his take in practice?
I think with the Carmina trials, which have much more clarity and the real role of the cytoreductive surgery in advanced cancers, except for a very small subset of patients with a good performance status, with a minimal extra renal disease and maybe one risk factor, that the intermediate grade, I think we should not offer the cytoreductive surgery for these patients, because the medical treatment is equally efficacious, and I think that should be the approach. The other indication we consider doing an nephrectomy would be when the patient has a bleeding or patient having got systemic symptoms. But otherwise, the cytoreductive surgery role has significantly come down with the data that we have today.
Okay, very good points. And Rajiv had mentioned that too. If it's a low-risk disease or intermediate with majority of the bulk in the kidney, those could be the subsets for surgery, or if it's a symptomatic patient, otherwise systemic treatment would be the way to go. So coming to the systemic treatment, Rajiv had really done a quick fire, you know, difficult to get through it. So I'll once again ask Philip, you know, a patient comes with metastatic RCC, what would he do? And he should comment on his choice in a favorable risk patient. Arun, you need to unmute.
Yes, sir. I am unmuted, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yeah, audible.
Yeah, so I think when we come across patients with RCC, the most important factor, as Dr. Rajiv also mentioned, is to risk stratify them in the first step. So we need to know whether they fit into the low risk, intermediate risk, or the high risk category of the IMDC, because that makes a lot of difference in the way we are going to manage them subsequently. So so once we have the risk stratification for these patients, I think for patients who are in a favorable risk, so having said that, the number of patients that we come across in this particular risk category may be very, very few. The majority of our patients may go into the intermediate or the high risk category. So for the favorable risk patients, that means patients who do not have any of these IMDC risk factors, the current recommendation as standard of care is immunotherapy. So immunotherapy and a combination with one of the VEGF TKIs. So pembrolizumab plus axitinib probably is the one that we have to go by as far as data is concerned. Now, we know that in our practice, the number of patients who are eligible for immunotherapy, mainly because of finances, are going to be very few. So in our practice, as is the same in my practice as well, majority of our patients would be going on one of the VEGF TKIs, either sunitinib or pazopanib. So it would not be a very bad choice either, because when you look at the nivolumab ipilimumab trial, we know that the favorable subgroup did better with sunitinib compared to the IO-IO combination. So the CheckMate 214 showed that the numerically the PFS and OS is better than the sunitinib arm in the favorable risk subgroup. So that is why EP plus NIVO combination has become standard in the intermediate and poor risk category. So my favorable risk patients, definitely if they are not candidates for pembro plus axitinib, most of them, more than 80% of them would be going on one of the VEGF TKIs, mainly pazopanib or sunitinib.
One quick thought to you, because whenever we are asking our own colleagues, we are saying that if you are going to write a TKI, we are going to write pazopanib. But whenever we look at all the clinical trials, the comparative arm is sunitinib. So do the investigators think that sunitinib is the right drug to compare, or they are using sunitinib so that there is more side effects and, you know, in the adverse profile, we get benefited for the other combination? What would be your thoughts? See, we are always talking, comparator is always sunitinib, never pazopanib. So any thought on that?
Yeah, that's correct, sir, because the initial data all, we know that the landmark trial with sunitinib versus interferon alpha came up way back in the early 2000s. So the first drug to get approved in the VEGF TKI realm was sunitinib. And most of the data on VEGF TKI in metastatic RCC is with sunitinib. So the reason why we brought pazopanib into treatment paradigm is probably because of the COMPASS trial and the PISCES trial, where it was compared with sunitinib head-on. And efficacy-wise, it seemed equal, and it probably seemed to be better tolerated than sunitinib. And the reason why we use pazopanib practice is because of the cost. Sunitinib still continues to be costly, much costlier than pazopanib. Except if the patient is BPL, of course, they get a free drug from the company. So majority of our patients go on pazopanib. One reason, because we have data comparing the efficacy, and we know that it is probably equally efficacious with much lesser toxicity. And as you rightly said, all these trials, all the IO-IO combination trials and IO-TK trials, all the comparator arm was sunitinib. So probably that's because of the fact that it was the first one to come up, and it's the TKI with the most data. So that's probably one of the reasons. Also, there may be an industrial aspect to it as well, as you said.
Okay, Philip, thank you. So coming to Rakesh, so this is the same patient, but intermediate risk. So how would you decide? You have all the opportunity. There is no restriction, no financial restriction, no logistics. So how would you take on this patient for treatment?
Good morning, everyone. With Keynote and this IO-IO combination, the ideal is you divide between the two groups, whether to use IO-IO or IO with TKI. With you are supposed to keep in mind the progression or the rapidity of the disease burden progression or the volume of the disease with maybe some comorbidities, because the response rate is more with pembroxetinib to the range of somewhere around 60%. And the curve, as Dr. Rajiv has said, the curve started separating early in pembroxetinib arm. But it was the data is just of 2 years, whereas in IO-IO combination the data is somewhere of 4 years, and it's more promising data. So if the disease is not that very fast progressive, or the volume of disease is low, IO-IO is, I feel it may be better. keeping the comorbidities in mind, because somewhere around 20 or 30% of the patient of the IO-IO combination are supposed to require the corticosteroids at any point of time. So this way we can divide.
Very good. Any specific pathology which, you know, sometimes we all get excited and we want to give immunotherapy much more as part of the treatment, IO-IO? Both have immunotherapy, obviously, in what you said. Something like a sarcomatoid, where double agent has a more advantage.
Okay. Not sure.
If there is a bone involving only disease, would any TKI have advantage? The metastatic sites being only bone, would there be any specific advantage of any TKI like cabozantinib?
Cabozantinib will be better in such situation, considering low volume of disease and the toxicity profile of the all the three groups.
Right, Rakesh. So we'll come back to the bladder tumor now, and Piyush is there. Piyush, how do you approach this? You know, till now we didn't have much to do with metastatic bladder, but with Rajiv's presentation and so much of information. So a patient comes to you. How do you utilize clinical factors, pathological factors, and finally the molecular factors to take a decision on treatment?
Sir, so far, what I'm utilizing is the first two variables that you mentioned, the clinical factors, which include the performance status and the GFR of the patient, cisplatin eligibility, above 60 ml per hour. Apart from that, the pathological factor does make some prognostic or sometimes rarely in a neuroendocrine, pure neuroendocrine or small cell variant, probably I tend to go for a etoposide platinum. So that might be predictive from that matter. But otherwise, the molecular factors, I've just started doing PD-L1 testing and tumor mutation burden. I would do in coming times, probably looking at data. So far, I haven't done.
Okay.
Neither have I looked for the FGFR3 and 4 mutations so far. But yes, the data is compelling, and the drug being there available for somebody who can bring the drug to India, or if it can be brought, probably now we can look at it.
The very practical thoughts, because I too, I haven't asked and I have not looked at FGR, F3 at all as of now. But looking at the data, where with whatever Rajiv presented, where would you use immunotherapy in bladder cancer?
So
if everything is available.
So far, it is in the metastatic setting that I have been using, and would use from Monday morning as well, continue using on Monday morning as well. In the first line, the data has been a bit skeptical, using straight away alone immunotherapy because of some rapid progression happening. And therefore, if the biology is not very well understood, that is, if the TMB is not really known and if the PD-L1 is not really known, so there could be a progression happening. So the Javelin 100 data, which is there, the switch maintenance after chemotherapy, that looks very attractive. However, in my practice, I usually tend to give for those who are platinum eligible, cisplatin. Cisplatin eligibles, GemCis, and otherwise GemCarboplatin, if for the first few cycles, and thereafter consider for a switch maintenance, have a discussion on switch maintenance, or once they fail in the second line, immunotherapy is in the all the five molecules. Right now we have three molecules with us, so yes.
Thank you, Piyush. So I'll just wrap up this session. So some of the key points would be, in an ideal patient, low risk, who is having all the parameters satisfying low risk in a dedicated unit, in an understanding patient, follow up in a prostate cancer with active surveillance is possible. 2. If we have a non-metastatic CRPC, there is a definite role for the newer axis inhibiting drugs, and we have enzalutamide with us. And in a patient who is metastatic and has CRPC, there is role at looking at the genomics, looking at BRCA2, BRCA1, ATM, and various other genes. And we have PARP inhibitors which can be utilized, and PTEN loss, and we can have certain drugs which can be targeting AKT. So that could be some important information. And for RCC, always don't lose out on the basics. As soon as the patient comes, first stratify. Low risk, even though there may be few, TKI is still a good option in that. But if you have everything, obviously axitinib plus pembrolizumab will be the option. But a combination of pembro with cabozantinib is also really chasing very hard, as we have some information coming in this ESMO 2020. Once we come to intermediate risk, either it's a IO plus IO combination versus a TKI plus IO, then very nicely Rakesh had said, look at patient preferences, patient toxicities, and then try to align our drugs appropriately. And Piyush made very practical thoughts that he hasn't used much of all these newer factors as of now, but cisplatinum would be the key. Use the basic stratification, performance status, or whether any visceral involvement is there or not. These two parameters, if they are all favorable, non-visceral and good performance status, even with cisplatinum and gemcitabine, about 30% of them can have 5-year survivorship. But with the new data coming in, we have to definitely look at new molecules, particularly IO drugs and targeting drugs for the mutation. So thank you all. Thank all the panelists for the patient hearing and ISMPO for the opportunity. And have a great year, Purvish. I saw you there. And a very healthy and prosperous year for you.